Thank you very much, Lars. Dear Madame Rajavi, former Prime Minister Bonnevik, Mr. Lunestad, permanent secretary of the Nobel Institute, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it's indeed a not only nice but also a bit of an honor to be here in this building at the Nobel Institute, the world famous Nobel Institute, for this important seminar on issues relating to Iran. Thanks to the Institute for hosting us, and thanks to the Friends of a Free Iran who have taken the initiative in organizing this event today. The National Council of Resistance of Iran, which is an umbrella organization for the various Iranian exile groups, has been receiving more and more attention and support worldwide in recent years, particularly in Europe and in the United States. Now, the new support that has been coming forward comes from different elements in societies in Europe, in the US, and elsewhere. It comes from highly respected and well-known political leaders and politicians, and also a few former ones. And it comes from academics and experts on international affairs, in addition to the huge number of Iranians in exile. This support comes also at a time when the government in Tehran has intensified its efforts to discredit and undermine the opposition in exile and its leader, Madame Rajavi. But let me say that this increase in support is not a coincidence. And it's not surprising, as the NCRI represents the only plausible democratic alternative to the religious dictatorship that now rules Iran and has been moving rapidly towards becoming a nuclear power and hence not only a regional but also a global threat. For me, it was truly revealing a few years ago to read through and study the so-called 10-point plan for future Iran that the NCRI presented to the Council of Europe some years ago. For this document is essentially a political platform that I believe any Western Democratic Party could subscribe to and endorse, including my own party back home. This plan provides for the peaceful transfer of power to a government representative of the Iranian people, chosen in free and fair elections under the rule of law. The important point is legitimacy, that the leadership is chosen in free and fair elections and is representative of the majority of the people. The plan, furthermore, calls for the universal introduction of human rights, such as unimpeded freedom of expression, freedom of assembly, an independent judicial system, and indeed, freedom of religion, in other words, a secular state, and other such basic rights that people in our part of the world take for granted, including, and I would like to emphasize, including, perhaps in particular, also equal rights for women in all walks of life. And it's also part of this program that Iran should be a non-nuclear state, should be nuclear free, and that the death penalty should be abolished, which would be a real change in a country where the regime has so far this year in less than 2 months executed well over 100 of its opponents inside the country. The call for a regime change in Iran is therefore not based on any disrespect for religion or anything of that kind, but it is a call for representative democracy and basic human rights. All suggestions are that this regime in Tehran cannot, no more than any other totalitarian regimes, repressive dictatorships, cannot be trusted. And insofar as the nuclear issue is concerned, the role of the opposition in revealing information about the nuclear program and about nuclear sites, etc., the role of the opposition in revealing this should not be forgotten. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, the issue of a regime change in Iran is obviously a highly political international issue that governments need to approach with realism and caution, but still with determination and pressure. In other words, sanctions if necessary. This must be achieved mainly through dialogue and political means in line with the traditions and the ideals of the institute where we now find ourselves, the Nobel Institute. But this can, and I think it must, happen. Now, the second issue that I would like to address is also highly political, but even more so a humanitarian issue. This has to do with the roughly 3,000 Iranians in exile that are now kept in prison-like conditions in a camp outside Baghdad, a former US military camp, very inappropriately or even sarcastically called Camp Liberty. Not everyone in this audience may be familiar with the background on this situation. So for those people, I will explain this very briefly. Since the mid-80s, after the end of the Iran-Iraq war, a group of about 3,500 Iranians lived peacefully in a camp near the Iranian border called Ashraf. These were opponents of the clerical regime in Iran that chose to live this way and did so peacefully in Ashraf. After the US invaded Iraq in 2003, the United States gave every of these people, every person in the camp, a written personal guarantee for their security, a written personal document, a security guarantee, when these people handed over all weapons in their possession. When the US left Iraq, the Iraqi government took over this responsibility, but has regretfully not lived up to its commitments. And even worse, after repeated attacks, allegedly by Iraqi forces, and of course the Iraqi government at the present time is very closely linked to the regime in Tehran, after repeated attacks on Ashraf, where over 100 people were killed, the residents of Ashraf were moved to Camp Liberty less than 2 years ago in a deal sponsored by the United Nations and agreed to in good faith by Madame Rajavi. Camp Liberty is badly protected with terrible medical and sanitary conditions. Repeated attacks have led to many more deaths and injuries. An attack last year on the remaining few people in Ashraf who were there to look after property, try to protect the property that was left, led to over 50 deaths, where some people were killed, handcuffed with their hands behind their backs. In other words, they were murdered. 52 people were murdered, and 7 people were taken hostage and are still hostages, 6 women and 1 man. And these people are believed to be in the custody of the Iraqi authorities. They may face deportation to Iran, where they will most likely be summarily executed in line with the policies of the regime. This is, of course, totally unacceptable and completely intolerable. And the UN has failed these people, not to mention the United States, which has the greatest responsibility in this matter, and more so than any other country or organization. The UN has now appointed a new special representative for this situation. It's a respected lady from the US with a lot of international experience, and this provides some hope. But the key issue right now is to bring all these people out, bring them, and they all have formal refugee status granted by the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, who have been working so hard to help the people in Camp Liberty, as well as the friends of a free Iran, can turn their attention to their larger objective, which is a regime change in Iran on the basis that I outlined earlier. Thank you very much for your attention.